9 minutes after 9 o'clock, Free for All Friday. Good morning, everybody. And it's a beautiful Friday. Got a great weekend coming up right now. Gretchen Smith in the studio, Flagler Health Department. And Bob Snyder, our fearless leader with the Flagler County Health Department.
Good. Happy Friday, Flagler County. Thank you, David. So glad that we have this wonderful opportunity with you.
And I know we've got some good news with COVID, which we don't have a lot, but we do. So if you want to fill everybody in a little bit on that and let us know what could possibly be good news in Flagler County.
Well, I'll tell you, everyone, we're doing really great with vaccinations, number one. So let's talk about that. So far in the state of Florida, 4,710,000 people have been vaccinated. And in Flagler County, 33,193 folks have been vaccinated in our community. You know, the health department is doing the majority of the vaccinations out at the fairgrounds and other places. Of course, we have a great assist from Publix and CVS. I've heard this week that Walgreens Pharmacy Gretchen has vaccines as well. And Target, their pharmacy is run by CVS, and they do also. But the majority of it is with your health department. And listen to this statistic. 69% of persons over the age of 65 have been vaccinated in our community. I think we're ranked 7th out of all 67 counties regards to percent of population vaccinated. So we have it going on, David, here in Flagler County regarding vaccinations.
And so I think the question is, why is that? Dr. Bickle, good morning.
Morning.
We're just talking about the impressive statistics of success with COVID here in Flagler County. And, I mean, the real question would be, why here? Why not other counties?
Well, you know, I'm going to take a stab at it, and then Dr. Bickle and Gretchen, please chime in. So we're doing well with vaccinations, and we have the lowest case rate per capita of positive cases here in Flagler out of 67 counties. That's per 100,000 population. So I just don't believe that this happens by accident. I believe that we want to thank our Flagler County residents, our community partners, that together, we have it going on and we're doing the right things with respect to public health measures and just being careful. And that's why we got the lowest case rate. We are seeing a little bit of a spike the last 3 days. And I did check with staff this morning. We don't have any major or even minor outbreaks happening in the community.
How's our hospital doing?
Hospitalizations are down. Number of deaths have been 93 for the last two and a half weeks. Hospitalizations were 11 just yesterday, and that compares to in the 20s and 30s just a month and a half ago. So we're doing well.
And you know, another really good thing that's happening this week is we're starting to fan out that concept that we initially had, that we were going to start working with faith-based organizations to be able to bring the vaccine to their congregations, et cetera. So this week alone, we did Mount Calvary Baptist. We are doing St. Elizabeth Ann Seton this morning. Next week, we're adding...
we're going to be Parkview Baptist Church. We've been to United Methodist Bunnell. So we've been to about five churches so far.
Yeah, we've got Temple Beth Shalom that's going to come on board in the not too distant future. There's a church that's coming on board. So this is our way of being able to reach those smaller, more intimate communities. And, we'll spread the vaccine around town.
Do you think that being in a smaller town, it seems more accessible to get the vaccine testing than maybe in a big metro where, you know, you see on TV stadiums and cars, and it just seems like it's a bigger deal than you know, you feel more comfortable going to our fairgrounds or to the airport. Maybe it's not as overwhelming or it doesn't seem as big of a hassle as it would in a metro. I'm just guessing.
I think that the metro areas are definitely getting bigger supplies, so there's more opportunities to get vaccinated. But here, you know, it is, you know, a more intimate setting, I guess. But
Yeah, we're getting, we're doubling the amount of inventory that we had just 4 weeks ago, right? 800 first doses a week. Now it's up to 1,600. And we are expecting more. Dr. Scott Rifkes, our Surgeon General, said you will be swimming in vaccines by the end of April. And I believe that there's going to be a press conference today at 9 with the governor, and he's going to be talking about possibly lowering the age incrementally, and also heard that he may allow counties and jurisdictions to make their own decisions about lowering the age for the general population getting vaccinated. Right now, it's anyone over the age of 60. Of course, those firefighters, law enforcement, teachers, it's 50 years is the cutoff regarding age. So we're curious to see what the governor says this morning.
There was another term, and people that were like medically vulnerable or something like that. What Dr. Bickle, are you there?
I'm here.
Sounds like you're walking through leaves. Is that true?
I am. It's beautiful. I'm in this beautiful bucolic wood setting in the hammock.
All right.
The governor's executive order said that besides this age limit and these individuals that are priority groups for vaccinations, he said anyone who is deemed by their physician to be extremely vulnerable to getting COVID. So that would be individuals with hypertension, diabetes, COPD, CHF, etc. All we need is just this one little form to be signed. It's a real simple form by someone's physician, and you can use that to get an appointment, to get scheduled for vaccines at the fairgrounds or wherever we're going to be out in the community. And kind of related to that, on April the 8th, everyone, Gretchen, we got to let folks know about this. April the 8th, we're going to have a special vaccination clinic at the hospital in partnership with the foundation, the Diabetes Alliance, the hospital, and us to vaccinate those individuals who are persons with diabetes, you know, the extremely vulnerable group. Per the governor's EO, we want to get you vaccinated. There's flyers already been produced, so I'll let Gretchen kind of talk about it a little bit here.
Yeah, so our Diabetes Education Center, Alana Shawa and Melissa Phillips have been working really hard on this, and we're going to be opening up a special community event for people with diabetes. It's going to be Thursday, April 8th at the Advent Palm Coast, and if you're under age 60, you need to bring that consent form, but apparently a lot of doctor's offices have them on hand.
Yes.
Getting used to kind of doing this. We'll have staff from our Diabetes Education Center. They'll all be on site with recipes, samples, answers to your questions, etc. And they're looking forward to it. It's going to be from 9 to 12. And if people are interested, they need to call and make a reservation by calling 386-313-7263. And actually, Melissa Phillips is going to be on our radio show tomorrow with me at 11:30.
Okay. All right. Well, very good. Is it, you know, is this in a way, because the whole COVID thing, you know, most people didn't really pay a whole lot of attention to their local health department because they really didn't have a reason to, right? Went about their life, had their doctor, had all this, and it's nice to know the health department's there for whatever. But, you know, through all this COVID, it's kind of created a relationship with the health department, with you, Bob. You know, a lot of people didn't really know who Bob was. You came and did your thing. Of course, Gretchen, everybody knows Gretchen. Dr. Bickle, you know, who's been, you know, here. He's a Flagler Live, does the question to ask the doctor.
That's right.
He's been on the program here. You know, is this, you know, where does it go from here with the relationship that you have with the community?
Well, I think it's increased awareness about what the department is all about and what we do. I'm going to use the fairgrounds as an example. So here we have 50 staff members and volunteers at the fairgrounds. What, 3 days this week? We're giving out 500 to 600 shots each day that we're there. So people are coming through. It's a drive-through event. And for those of you who have been at the fairgrounds, we're getting real positive feedback with respect to the smoothness of the operation, the friendliness of our staff and volunteers. I mean, it's a real positive experience to begin with, because after all, you are getting liquid gold in your arm. You are getting the vaccine. but it's done in just a very accommodating, friendly way. And we've just gotten so many kudos from people in the community. So this is a great opportunity, right, Dr. Bickle, for our health department, because we do provide many services for our community on a routine daily basis. And I think it just raises awareness, and I think it just establishes a real stronger relationship between our health department and people in the community.
Dr. Bickle, since you're walking and talking, comment.
I think, you know, most of the time the health department's kind of operating in the background, providing certain services that are kind of safety net, and then things that people might not notice, like environmental and vaccinations and stuff. The pandemic has brought everything out, you know, right out into the open. And hopefully we won't, you know, be going on like this for the next pandemic and all this other stuff, but I think it does show the community what the public health department has to offer.
There, you know, we're talking about swimming and vaccinations and all that, and there is some talk about a decline in willingness, particularly amongst a younger demographic, to even get vaccinated. So, I mean, we could be looking at, okay, don't send us any more vaccinations to Flagler County. Our refrigerators are full. Is that a possibility?
It is. There are some smaller counties right now that are experiencing that phenomena, but most of the larger counties are not. We're not. I spoke to Jonathan Lord this morning on the phone, and we seem to be in this sweet spot place where we're not getting a lot of frustrated phone calls of people being concerned about getting an appointment. They're able to get an appointment if they want, and we seem to have the supply to accommodate that.
Yeah, I will say that early on, I spent half my day, it felt like, responding to senior citizens and saying, when are we going to get our vaccine, et cetera. That traffic has all but completely dried up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah.
That's a good thing.
Yeah, it is
very
good.
Okay.
if people out there over 65 still haven't gotten their shots yet, please, please, please give a call to the health department. You can ask for me. Our number is 437-7350.
Okay. By the way, I'm supposed to, or text, if you have questions, we don't really take phone calls on the program here for various reasons, but if you have a question that's pertinent to the conversation, you can text it, and we can see it right here in the studio at 386-866-0940. That's 866-0940, and we'll ask the question live as you want. But, Dr. Bickle, what do you think? What are you reading with the decline with younger demographics in willingness to get? What's their reasoning? What's their thinking? To come to a conclusion of, I'm not going to get it? And I played golf with somebody that I'm not going to say works for the county who said, he said, I have type O blood, so I don't need to get one. Is that true, that type O blood people are not as likely to or susceptible to COVID?
There is some evidence that they're less susceptible to get severe disease. It's kind of sketchy. It's not. A lot of these correlation studies, they don't show cause and effect. They just show this shows something related, and you don't quite know what and why. But I think with young people in general, it's just perceived lower risk. And we're not done with this. You know, this is a marathon, this vaccination race. And, you know, I think we've talked about this before, that, you know, we're going to go through these three phases. We're now in the second phase. The first phase was, you know, supply deficit, you know, demand overwhelming it. And then now we're in the sweet spot, like Bob was saying, where a lot of people still need to get it, and we got a lot of vaccine. And then we're going to go probably within a month, 6 weeks, to this thing where we were swimming in vaccine, and we're going to be really pushing outreach to get every last person vaccinated. The thing that we're going to be continuing to promote is that there are some real tangible benefits to having a high vaccination rate in our community in terms of freeing up our lifestyles, getting business back to normal. So even if the younger people aren't as vulnerable, there's a lot to say for getting vaccinated. It's one less thing you have to worry about. And some young people do end up in the hospital. So it's not like there's no risk here, I think. And the other thing is, it's just the same thing with the vaccine hesitancy a few months ago when nobody could get vaccine anyway. The young people haven't had an option. So when it's really presented to them, they may change their mind. I think there has been, you know, a growing awareness on the throughout the country that these vaccines really work, and they're very effective. So the credibility is going up.
Yeah, and I'm thinking, too, of even people that work at our own health department, the younger folks, and people just around me in general. You know, the feeling is I'm not going to get the virus. It's just not going to come my way. But the thing is, 40% of the folks who get the virus are asymptomatic, and it's still transmissible from younger person to older person. So that's why we are just so concerned about this issue, and that we want everyone to get vaccinated and still, you know, take public health precautions into account. Because it's still out there, especially with the variants. Now, we're real lucky. I want to bring that up because in Flagler County, we've only have 2 cases of the variant, the British variant, so far. 5 in Volusia County, about 800 cases of this statewide in Florida. But it is spreading around the country, more so in other states. So I think that's another reason why public health measures, precautions, the mask wearing, and strongly consider getting vaccinated. You know, for that reason, because the vaccines, right, Steve, they are effective in dealing with the variant that is most prominent in the U.S., that U.K. variant.
Yeah, that's true. And the other thing I want to point out is that, you know, people get a lot of vaccinations, and, you know, to measles and chickenpox and all this other stuff. COVID is a bigger risk to anybody in our county in the next year than any of the other things they get vaccinated for. So the potential benefit from the vaccine is quite dramatic, especially this year. So that's another reason to do it.
Okay, mask wear. First time in a year I've seen Gretchen and Bob Snyder sitting here without a mask on, and I had no idea you have a full beard, by the way. I'm talking to Bob, not Gretchen.
Thank you.
Okay, so why is it that suddenly here today we don't have a mask on?
Well, before the show began, I said, hey, all 3 of us have been vaccinated, and the CDC, as everyone knows, just came out with new recommendations and guidance, and basically in small groups and gatherings of people who have all been vaccinated, the risk is so minimal that, yeah, you do not need to wear your mask. It's just when you're out and about in the public and you're exposed to medium and large gatherings, that's where the risk is higher, and that's why we're still saying wearing your mask. But small family units, which we are here right now in the studio, 3 of us, we've all been vaccinated. So we are protected, and we're just protected. We've protected each other in terms of transmissibility of the vaccine unknowingly because of the asymptomatic issue. The vaccine still can embed itself. The virus still can embed itself in your nasal passages. So, but we're a family unit here. We've all been vaccinated, so it is safe.
Text question: can Dr. B shed any light on if vaccinated, can we still get variants, and will the symptoms be reduced if you do because of the vaccination?
Yes. The answer is you can, less likely, symptoms generally less, likelihood of an asymptomatic infection much higher, and it also depends on the variant. The UK variant seems to be very close to susceptible to natural immunity and the vaccine-induced immunity as the wild type, and South African less so, but still seems fairly susceptible. It's one reason to get vaccinated even if you've had COVID, because the vaccines induce a level of immunity that seems to be more protective against a variety of variants than just natural immunity. So it's still a moving target.
Okay. Another question is, if I've had my first vaccination, and if I don't get a second vaccination, is it really basically that important?
Yes. Yes, it is important. You want to be protected as long as you can, and you want to have the highest level of protection. The data on protection from one dose, it's not a lot. There are not a lot of data on it, and it's not as protective. So it still helps, but why would you not want to get the second one? I mean, it gives you long-lasting, very high levels of immunity.
And then the other part of that question was, so if say they had their first vaccination, they got the other one scheduled 2 weeks later, how much, if they don't do it 2 weeks later, how much further can they have it? If it's not 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, what would it still be effective to have a second one?
There aren't a lot of data on this either, but based on other vaccination programs and response rates and timing and stuff, you probably have a month window beyond the scheduled date. But we don't. It's like we're not trying to push it for people. We don't really know for sure. But a few weeks is not going to hurt things. But like I said, it's still worth getting it done, getting it over with.
Yeah. So, Dr. Bickle, I had a client call yesterday. They had just got vaccinated, and they wanted to know they were going to be away when they were scheduled to come back. So they wanted to know if they could do it the week before or the week after. And they said the week before was much more convenient, and they wanted to travel, knowing that they had both vaccinations. And I said, well, I believe that you're supposed to wait. It's okay to wait till the week after.
Week after is better, actually. What happens is if you get there's the second shot does something different with the immune system than the first shot. The immune system's already primed with the first shot. So when you get the second shot, all these cells are ready to go. They create better antibodies. Other cells get activated. It's really a durable, robust response. And if you do it too soon, you just get the same reaction as the first time. So it's actually worse. That's why they picked the 3 weeks. Three or 4 weeks is like the minimum amount of time you have to wait to get that second qualitative reaction to the immune triggering. So yeah, waiting a week is way better. A week after or even 2 weeks after is way better than. In fact, I don't think they give it to you early anyway.
And
it's not indicated.
An important point is that second shot, we call it the booster shot, that brings the efficacy rate up to 95% for Moderna and Pfizer both. Johnson & Johnson is one shot, and we did have 800 vaccines of Johnson & Johnson that we used for teachers and school district staff at one of our pods last Saturday at the gym. And that's very effective, too, and it's a one-shot deal. But that Moderna and Pfizer are just very effective, and that's why that second shot is so, so important.
All right, well, here's another one. These questions are coming out of answers here. But if I miss my second dose, do I have to start over? In other words, I guess if a month or two goes by since the first dose, do they have to get the two vaccinations again starting over? I guess is what they mean.
No. Just pick up where you left off.
Okay.
Where you left off. And the other thing people need to realize is these boosters are a very well recognized and sort of longly used method of enhancing immunity. And there's a whole science to it. This has been very well worked out for these particular vaccines. So we're getting the benefit of a lot of science on how the immune system works.
All right, well, here's another combination. It's like, you know, how many ways can you do a combination? Here's another combination is if I didn't get my second Moderna, can I get a Johnson & Johnson, and just get one of those? And is there a problem in mixing the two?
There is. I'll let Steve expound further, but no, they're not interchangeable, right, Dr. Bickle?
Yeah, the thing is, 6 months ago, there was all this consternation in the public about, are the vaccines going to be proven? Are we rushing it? Are we not building public trust by not getting the right data? We have all the data now for these vaccines in the way that they are designed to be given. Anything else, you're kind of just, taking a shot at it. So there's no point in it. We know the vaccines work in a prescribed manner. That's really what we're promoting, is people just stay with the program.
But the science, right, the science and research is really clear. If you got the Moderna, you stick with Moderna for that second dose. Same with Pfizer. They're not interchangeable.
Okay.
Right. I mean, they may actually get studied, but there are no data on it right now.
Okay.
Or certainly no published data.
All right, let's see. Another one. They saw a report that tall people are more susceptible to getting it than short people.
Man, I am so... That's a one-time 5'6". That's me, and I'm kind of glad I'm short. No.
So I guess, you know, all these statistics are coming out that like tall people are more apt percentage to get COVID than people that are short. Any, has crossed anything in your medical journals on that one, Dr. Bickle?
I haven't even seen that one, but yeah. it's this correlation is not causation issue.
Right. All kidding aside, yeah, we have not seen anything that touts that to be true.
All right.
And but if you're tall and you want to use that as a motivator to get vaccinated, go for it.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I don't even know what the definition of tall would be or what short would be, actually. So
when I lived in New York City, there was a tall club of New York City, and for women, you had to be 5'10", and men had to be 6'2".
Isn't that discrimination?
I guess. But anyway, I was too short to be in the tall club of New York.
All right, one more here, and then we got to take a break, but I appreciate, if I didn't have any symptoms when I got my vaccine, how do I, maybe did it not take, and because they had no symptoms from it, and so I guess meaning
that, like, was a reaction vaccine, or something.
Yeah, so a reaction is a good thing, that you know it happening, or is no reaction at all that it didn't take, is the word they used.
No reaction is fine. But keep in mind, these studies showed 95% efficacy in all comers, regardless of whether they reacted or not, 100% efficacy preventing severe disease in all comers. So that's pretty darn reassuring. If you get a reaction, it probably does mean you had a vigorous response. But if you didn't get one, you still had a plenty vigorous enough response to protect yourself.
We do get lots of calls and comments about a small minority group of people who do get maybe a slight fever, the fatigue after their first or second shot. And as Dr. Bickle has said, that is a normal reaction. Don't sweat that at all, because it means that your immune system is being, using your words, Steve, your immune system is being revved up.
All right.
Yeah, one last thing. The only group that is being considered for one shot only, and still the recommendations are two shots, but the only group is people who've had COVID before and then have a big reaction to their first shot. They're studying it and to see how durable their immune response is. Currently, these recommendations are still for the second shot, but that may change.
Okay.
And we have breaking news here on the radio. We'd like to share it with our listeners.
Governor DeSantis will lower vaccine age eligibility to 50 starting Monday.
Yay!
So
if you want
to get on the list.
Yeah. Everyone go to myvaccineflorida.gov, myvaccineflorida.gov, or call 866-201-201. 1541 to get an appointment to come join us out at the fairgrounds.
All right. Hey, we got to take a break.
One last thing is that'll probably mean in a couple weeks it'll be 40. So
right.
People can look forward to that.
Great. Dr. Bickle, can you hang on? We have somebody who is a big fan of yours that's going to be joining us here right after the break. Can you hang with us?
Yeah, I'm just doing my walk.
Okay. All right, we'll be right back on Free for All Friday. I'm David Ayres, Gretchen Smith. We have got Bob Snyder, Dr. Bickle, and we'll be joining our new friend, Ashley Olson, when we return.
So you're ready to list it? We're ready to sell it. This is Sam Perkovich, broker owner of Parkside Realty Group. Stop by our office in Town Center or call us at 302-0300. Visit us online at parksiderealtygroup.net.
We are not very good at picking winning stocks and bonds.
We don't like roller coasters.
But we are good at helping people with winning tax strategies.
With new tax laws taking effect in the new year,
we can make sure you're on the right track,
so you have no surprises.
Personal or business, we're here to help.
Call us today for a free consultation.
Flagler Tax Service. Call 793-7156.
You didn't hear it from me.
Your neighbor is probably sleeping with us, and they're probably pretty happy. Who wouldn't be? With up to 75% off our brand new mattresses and adjustable beds. Never pay retail. Come and see us. We're Bedtops Mattress Clearance Center in Palm Coast. We're easy to find in the Hargrove Industrial Park off US 1. Call us anytime at 386-627-4188. Bedtops Mattress Clearance Center. And don't tell your neighbor we were talking about them.
Don't give in to dirty rain. Protect your car with a super wash sign. A soft, plump, gentle wash every time. Our name says it all. Super wash.
Super wash, super wash.
Superwash Express wants to help keep you healthy. Superwash is now offering free sanitation services on every full-service interior cleaning using the most advanced technology, like the interior fogging technique that kills germs and disinfects the air in your car, as well as sanitizes the door panels, the dashboard, and the seats. The Superwash Express service team then sanitizes all the touch points in the automobile, steering wheel, door handle, gear shifter, and the key fob. Don't give in to the dirt, grime, and germs. Come in for a Superwash shine. Fast and friendly, open in rain or shine Monday through Sunday with locations in Port Orange, Palm Coast, Ormond Beach, Daytona Beach, and Mount Dora. Don't give in to the dirt and grime. Come on in for a super wash shine.
Super wash centers.
9:40, free for all Friday. We've got some rain coming in over the weekend, but we're enjoying the weather here in this part of Florida. And with us, if you just tuned in, Free For All Friday, and of course we podcast this so you can listen to it in its entirety and all the previous shows. I listened to one a year ago, by the way, and it was, yeah. I mean, we were talking about the hospital putting up the emergency giant circus tent, and, yes. And how the, I mean, you could hear the kind of the fear and lack of really confidence in Bob Snyder as far as what the hell is going on here and where are we going. But I mean you know, your
thought, David, that we'd be dealing with a global pandemic that hadn't occurred in 103 years throughout the world, and then it's, you know, so present in all of our communities.
Well I mean there were so many questions and not a lot of answers back then, and that's, you know, right. But everybody did their best, and everybody, you know, and so here we are a year later, looking pretty damn good, I think.
Yeah, we're getting there. We're gaining on this, everyone. I mean, we have a very high vaccination rate here in the county. We have the lowest case rate out of 67 counties per capita. So it tells me that we are doing something right. We have it going on here. This does not happen by accident. So whatever it is we're doing, let's keep going.
Okay. Hey, I'm going to see Mark, by the way, our engineer producer, is getting married today. So
yes,
he has the day off. So if there's any engineering screw-ups, I take full responsibility. So let's let's take a big wish here. Ashley Olson, are you with us?
Yes, I am.
Yeah. All right. Good. I pushed the right buttons here. And Dr. Bickle, are you still with us?
Yes, I am.
Oh, David, you're doing great.
All right. Ashley, say good morning to everybody.
Hi, good morning. How is everyone doing?
Good, Ashley. Good morning to you.
You've been listening in, and you've been listening to Dr. Bickle, and I know you said that you were kind of a fan of his. You were wanting to meet him, so here you are.
Yes. Hi, how are you?
I'm great, Ashley. Nice to meet you.
So
virtually.
Yes. So we talked about national NMO. We've been teasing it a little bit, and we kind of threw it at Dr. Bickle with the but here's somebody that really knows about it because she got it. Ashley, tell us a little bit about yourself and how you became introduced to something called NMO.
Well, it started about 6 weeks after giving birth to my son in 2006. I had walked into a spider web and gotten bit and started losing my vision. My friend was an ER doctor at the time, and he said that the vision loss was most likely due to the spider bite. It didn't actually cause the NMO. It just triggered it. I already had the disease in my body, but we think from the combination of the birth and a vaccine that I had received and the spider bite, it was just like the perfect storm to activate it.
What kind of spider was it?
One that bit me. I have no clue.
She's not here as a spider expert, Gretchen.
No, okay, yeah,
but that's a good question.
We don't know. I just started itching, and then I woke up one morning, and there was pus coming out of it, and I couldn't see out my eye. Mm. And the doctor said that once the infection went away, the vision would come back, and it did. And exactly 1 year later, it went out again, and this time I was up north for a wedding. And everybody around me was like, it could be something serious. You have to get it looked at. And I was only 21. I was in perfect health. And I didn't think it was a big deal. And then once I got home, I was like, yeah, let's get this checked out.
Did it bite you in the eyeball?
It bit me on my temple. And that's why they thought it was affecting the vision. Because it was right there on the temple.
And you felt it? You knew that you could feel it bite you?
No, I didn't feel anything. I had walked into the spider web, and I was carrying my infant son, and I checked him to make sure the spider didn't get on him. And the next morning, I woke up with the infection, and we just figured it was from the spider.
So where did it go from there over how much time until you knew what it was?
Well, that first attack happened in 2006. And then exactly 1 year later that attack happened in 2004. And then exactly 1 year later in April of 2005, I had another optic attack. And this time I listened to everybody, and I just went to a local optometrist, 2020 Eye Care. And he had said that the optic nerve looked pale and flat, but he couldn't pinpoint anything. So he referred me to a neuro-ophthalmologist. And the neuro-ophthalmologist said that I would most likely come down with MS within 10 years. And I knew that that wasn't it. There's no autoimmune conditions in my family. And I was like, that's not it. And I'm grateful that they didn't put me on MS medications because they can make the disease so much worse for NMO patients.
So it was a misdiagnosis, right?
Yeah, I was misdiagnosed for about a year and a half, left untreated. November, Thanksgiving of 2006 is when I had my optic attack in the left eye, and that's what left me with the vision I have. And I have no vision in the left eye, and I'm 2400 in the right eye. At that time, we knew that something was wrong, so my mom found a local neurologist to admit me into the hospital and do steroids because my neuro-ophthalmologist was going off of the MS diagnosis. And at that time, steroids for MS was a new thing. And they found that with MS patients, they kind of get better without the high doses of steroids. But with NMO patients, it's very crucial to hopefully prevent any damage. So they admitted me and ran all sorts of tests, and every test was coming back negative. The only thing that looked out of ordinary was that I had no infections, but my white blood count was at 25. Hmm. So they knew something was going on with the immune system. I was released from the hospital, and that weekend, this was all in December of 2006, that weekend I went out and saw my mom. Everything was fine. And I got a phone call that following morning saying she had an accident and she was airlifted to the hospital. So I put my health on hold to be by her bedside. And I remember walking into the hospital one day with a friend, and he's like, why are you shaking your arm like that? And at that time, I was going through my first transverse myelitis attack, which is another symptom of NMO. And I didn't know that that's what it was, so I kind of just disregarded it, went about my life. And then after my mom's passing in January, I knew that I needed to focus on me because I had a one-year-old. I had to take care of myself for him. So I called the University of Florida neuro-ophthalmology department, and they said it could take up to 7 months for me to get in. So I decided to go through their ER because I knew that they would have to follow up within 7 days. And within a week, I was seeing their specialist. And I had a bunch of tests ran, and he sat down that day, and I explained everything that went on, and he said that he had a 99.9% guarantee I had neuromyelitis optica.
Hmm. Now, did your sight come and go during this time period, and what is your sight like today?
Well, my last optic attack was in November of 2006, and I am considered legally blind. I have a guide dog, so I can get around. If you met me, you would probably look at me and be like, she's not blind. But once you hung out with me for a little bit, you'd be like, oh, yeah, she's blind.
Is it Dr. Bickle being, you know, this is kind of a, and it's called neuromyelitis optica? Is that close?
Yes, but okay. It's also been, the spectrum disorder has been added onto it for the negative patients because there are people who test negative for the aquaporin 4 antibody. And we all have a little bit of that antibody in our body, but my body doesn't know how to shut it off. So I believe in 2008, they added the SD onto it to include the seronegative patients. And yes, we don't like to be compared to MS.
Dr. Bickle, I know, you know, since we kind of brought this up a few weeks ago, letting everybody know Ashley was going to be on. Is this an MO? It's National Awareness Month. Is it? Sounds like it's a real rare thing. Have you ever come across it in your career?
I've never had a patient with it. I'm aware of it, and actually mostly what I know about it is reading up on it after you brought it up to me. And what Ashley said is quite true, that it used to be kind of buried in the multiple sclerosis world, and because there are a lot of overlapping symptoms. They actually have different modes of pathophysiology, where MS is more a T-cell triggered condition, mm-hmm. and this is more an antibody triggered condition, which makes a big difference in terms of how it's treated. But I think, like a lot of medical conditions, the clearer, as they got a better idea of what was going on, the treatments got better. Right, Ashley?
Yes. As of this year, we have 3 FDA-approved drugs just for NMO. And NMO, they've realized that they can suppress attacks because none of our preventatives guarantee us not to have an attack. Like, we could wake up paralyzed or blind or anything at any moment. But, like, I'm on Rituxan, and they've noticed that with Rituxan, it depletes the B cells. So they're thinking it's more of a B cell disease than versus MS, where it's a T cell. It did used to be considered a severe case of MS. I believe in China, it was considered spinal MS. And it was actually discovered in 1894 by a doctor of the name Jean Devix. And then in 2006, they discovered the antibody, which made it its own distinct disease.
Ashley, the spider bite triggered this in you. Are there other things that can do it other than spiders?
Infections, anything that boosts the immune, infections, stress, giving birth, anything. I mean, if we get a cold, it can, because it triggers the immune system, it can cause us to have an attack because our immune system, they're kind of like overactive immune systems. They just don't know when to stop and shut off, and it looks at the optic nerves, the brain, and the spinal cord as the foreign invader, and it starts attacking it and eating the myelin around the nerve.
Bob Snyder.
So, Ashley, so you're on a medication regimen right now, is that right?
Yes. I've done 3 of the different medications that are off-label. I've done Emuran, which is typically not used anymore. And then I switched to Celcept, and in 2017, I had another transverse myelitis attack after being stable for 11 and a half years. So the disease is manageable, and with NMO, you won't get worse as long as you stay stable. Well, I was on Celcept for about 2 years, and I kept on getting frequent sinus infections. And I convinced my doctors to run my IgG levels, and they were extremely low. A typical IgG level is between 700 and, I want to say, about 15. Mine was at 114. So we decided to switch to another medication that's intravenous, and I've been on that for 2 years, and I'm doing good.
Great.
It's kind of, you know, it's, well, thank God you kind of took your own health into your own hands, because...
Oh, yeah, you have to.
I mean, you know, and everybody, of course, was trying. There was just ignorance to what this NMO was from the doctors and people that you were running across there. You started a foundation to draw attention to this to help other people. Can you tell us about that?
I did. I have volunteered alongside other organizations. We have two amazing foundations already, the Foundation and the Sumera Foundation. And working with these foundations, I quickly realized, yes, they're devoted to finding a cure, and we all want a cure. I mean, the work that they have done in the last 10 years is absolutely amazing. But nobody is looking after the patient, and at any time, we can be robbed of our eyesight, our mobility, and insurance companies will only pay for so much, and that's where we want to step in and be able to help people.
All right. So how can we help you? God love you, by the way, for going through everything that you did, and so life today is, so for the rest of your life, you're going to be blind in one eye and legally blind in the other?
Yes. But I tell people all the time, if this is all NMO takes from me, I'm fine with it. Because, like, I have a close friend, her daughter is 4 years old, and she has one of the most severe cases of NMO. Nothing is stopping this little girl's attacks. And they've even opened a brand new study to get this girl into it to see if they can stop the attacks. So, I mean, honestly, if this is all it takes, I'm good. Life's not that bad being blind.
Nah. And I know you're friends because Trent Ferguson, who was our sports director, he's been blind since birth. But somehow, yeah. How did you become friends with him, or how did you meet Trent?
Well, he did a show with Domino from Sunny FM, and I'm friends with Domino on FB. So his post caught my attention, and then we started talking about the blind school in St. Augustine, and we've just been friends ever since.
All right. So if we want to help you and a Breath of Life Foundation, how can we find you, Ashley?
You can check us out at breathofhopefornmo.org, and we're also on Facebook.
All right.
We're fairly new, so we're a little foundation, but one day we'll be big. We'll be known.
All right. Well, keep in touch here. We appreciate you. Dr. Bickle, we're going to let you go. Enjoy your weekend. And any final words from Dr. Bickle?
Yeah, just one thing. It takes a special kind of courage to deal with serious chronic illness. I've seen it in patients. If you haven't had this experience, you don't know about it. But I see it all the time. And I just, my heart goes out to you, Ashley. And I can obviously tell you have that courage. And I hope it does. Hope things go very well for you.
Thank you. It helps that I have an amazing support team.
All right. All right, guys. Well, hey, have a great weekend. Be safe and enjoy, okay?
All right. Yes, you too.
All right, we're going to wrap it up, but just walking in, one of our good friends, Jamie from the Beachfront Grill. You're doing something good for the community, and you've got like 30 seconds to tell us about it.
Well, hey, Dave. No, we have a golf outing this Monday, and all the money that comes in goes to the Flagler Beach Police and the Flagler Beach Fire Departments, Chief Downey and Chief Pace. They do a great job. A bunch of brave men and women on both sides of that, blue and red. And anybody who wants to donate to the cause, please stop down the bar or call the bar. If you want to make a donation, let us know. We'll make sure you get mentioned and make sure all the money goes to the right place.
So why do we, you know, taxpayers paid the police and fire department and everything. Why is Jamie and Beachfront Grill throwing money in there?
Well, you know that they also have little charities set aside, too, for to help other people out that people inside don't know about. On the outside are unaware of that. But these guys do on these men and women both help out other people in need.
So this is a charity that you've started to help Flagler Beach?
It's actually their charities. I just donate to them.
Oh,
and,
okay.
So everybody comes in, gives the money to us, and we raise the money and donate it back to Chief Downey and Chief Pace and let them do what they need, or else if they need some things inside the department, like bulletproof vests or things like that, then they're welcome to use it for whatever they need.
All right. Well, great. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you, David. Great to see you.
Yeah, same here. I hear you on the radio all the time. That's very often.
Face for radio. I hate to use your lines, but right.
All right, Jamie at Beachfront. So that's good. And the tournament, I heard, is just finally just got sold out, so you don't need golfers. But you can. Anybody wants to donate to it, they can get with you at the Beachfront Grill.
They sure can. Thanks,
right.
David.
You got it. We got to run. Gretchen Smith, any final words from you? By the way, you had a great show last week. I was listening to your gynecologist on there. And I was like, I wish he was my doctor, but once again, discrimination against us guys. But go ahead.
Really good show.
Yeah.
Tomorrow we have Mel Phillips from our diabetes, and tune in tomorrow at 11:30.
Okay. You got it. Bob Snyder, final.
Yeah, have a great weekend, everyone. Hey, Flagler County, let's get vaccinated. Come on.
All right, we're doing it. Thanks, everybody, for being a part of the big team in Flagler County. We're number one. Have a good weekend.